Peace and power, and welcome back. We are still watching the S Secret Life of Plants. Let me see. Yep, the Secret Life of Plants. And so let's get back into it.
In agricultural centers of the future, plants will show themselves to be fully rational beings, controlling their intake of water and nutrients, and even regulating the temperature and humidity of their environment. We're just beginning to understand the language of plants. It is a difficult and fascinating road wherein a multitude of surprises awaits us. From this beginning will come a world of harmony between mankind and nature. Through the gift of human ingenuity, all things are possible. All that we need is a peaceful sky above.
In what seems like the dead of winter, beneath a protecting mantle of ice, forces from faraway galaxies and from deep in the earth are joined in the creation of new life. The sun dies at the winter solstice, it will be reborn in the spring. Thank you.
If you wear glasses or contacts, you must see this. An award-winning doctor reveals an astonishing, natural way to reclaim the 2020 vision you were born with in record time. Did you know? Vision problems have absolutely nothing to do with your eyes. A shocking link between the eyes and the brain was discovered by researchers in Washington. These studies show that your eyes will deteriorate with each passing year, even if you wear glasses or lenses. And that's because they don't do a single thing to actually improve the way your eyes interact with the brain. This well-known doctor from Japan was forced out of his practice after he unveiled a billion-dollar secret.
With the world of plants has blossomed into a perennial love affair. All across the land, plant shops have sprouted, and no home or office is complete without its Dracaena or Boston fern. Like a field in high summer, horticultural and garden clubs are thriving. The National Onion Association of East Lansing, Michigan. The American Gourd Society of Mount Gilead, Ohio. Bonsai Club International of Menlo Park, California. North American Gladiolus Council. The Indoor Light Gardening Society of Bay Village, Ohio. The Society for Siberian Irises of South Harpswell, Maine. And the Delphinium Society of Minneapolis, Minnesota. Society produced a publication, the Jesnerian St. Paulia News, the New England Wildflower Notes, the Gourd, the Gloxinian, the Herbalist, the Seed Pod, the Begonian, the Medianite, the Red Blooming Iris Recorder, and the Spuria News. As the rapture spread, plant lovers could order a pepper plant direct from Venezuela, a candlestick plant from the West Indies, a Jacob's ladder from Malaysia, and from China, a strawberry begonia.
Ladies and gentlemen, imagine, if you will, a future in which we actually exchange information with those beautiful sentinels that surround our lives. Imagine receiving from plants, locked in their own dimension of time and space, a view of our own chaotic world. We see them as static, unmoving objects, and to them, perhaps... a hopelessly mechanical rush of pointless activity. Unimaginable. But in fact, we are a flurry of the absurd. Might be more aware of the responsibility that we have to our earth. Responsibility for the food we eat and the air we breathe given to us by the plants.
We are the absurd appendages of an ongoing nature, and nothing more. The plants alone prepared the earth for all life. For what have we prepared it?
I love my flowers so much that the reflection of my love comes back from the flowers. They produce the best they can ever.
I know that when I'm really happy, it shows in my plants. Like, I can really see that. I'll just walk around the house and all the plants are just shining and bright and growing and healthy. And if I'm not really happy, it's just like that shows in the plants too.
I understand that plants respond to music. So how do you like that?
This 1st of November, picking tomatoes.
When they bloom, they smell the house all over with the gardenia smells fantastic. And it's by a window, so like the smell just blows all through the house.
And not to forget the persimmons.
You don't have to look around or ask yourself and see it there.
I think a lot of people tend to be like a Jewish mother and, you know, give a lot of food or water to the plants.
I think that it's true for anything. Rock, you can communicate with rocks. People, I mean, they call people like that crazy.
You loved to hear her name, describing another's pretty name. But if ever there was choice, my power would be the pretty name.
Him with words all the time. It's like just plants are really hip to what you're doing and who you are and what's happening.
I don't think they understand English.
This is jalapeno pepper speaks Spanish.
Yeah,
I even love them sometimes, pick them up. I never mean to them, though. Like some people tell me they beat them and stuff like that, but I never do that. I've always loved them at all times, but they understand, you know.
Y'all, this is so good. Let me pause it. This is bringing back so many memories. I'm not going to get emotional. It's making me think of my grandmama, Katie Ruth. She used to wear little tailored dresses. And they were made just for her. It would fit her perfectly. And it's just like, recently, I've been wanting to get a sewing machine, but I digress. This is just so good, and you hear the people and how they speak about plants in a loving manner. I used to think that I was too emotional to teach gardening, because I do get kind of mad when people sprout seeds and then put no effort into seeing it through. It's like having kids. You would go to jail if you had a kid and stopped taking care of it. And so it's just a blatant disregard for plant life. Okay.
I know that maybe 75% of the Earth's land mass is vegetation. That is the natural world. Green, trees, plants, flowers, weeds, wild things growing all over the place. You sometimes lose track of that when you live in the city. You think that's the whole world. But from my plants, I get the constant reminder, hey, we're the real world. That's not.
In the heart of Africa, on the southwestern edge of the Sahara, lives a nation of peasant warriors who call themselves the Dogon. For centuries, they have remained fiercely independent, guarding their villages and fields against intrusion from the outside world. Living in widely scattered villages, in a turbulent landscape of sandstone, between huge escarpments and inaccessible cliffs, the Dogon cling to a strong religious identity, with concepts of nature and the universe that are unique among the so-called primitive peoples of Africa. These beliefs, interwoven in a tapestry of complex symbols and legends, are known only to a handful of tribal elders. The Temple of Aru is the repository of Dogon religious knowledge. Within its adobe walls are hidden countless objects of great spiritual importance to the tribe. But the essential element of the shrine is human. With no written language, the sacred knowledge of the Dogon lives in the memory of one man, the Ogan of Aru. Approached by the elders of the village, the Ogan alone can direct the course of their rituals. He alone remembers the sacred rites of the Sigi. The Sigi ritual, held only at 50-year intervals, celebrates the movements of the sacred star. It is the most important event in the Dogon world. In preparation for the ritual, a tribal artist begins an elaborate map of the universe. The words of the Ogan are translated into an astonishingly accurate view of the heavens. The planets of our solar system are shown in their proper orbits around the sun. The rings of Saturn and the moons of Jupiter, invisible to the naked eye, are described in accurate detail. But most remarkable is their knowledge of a distant star called by them Potolo. Named for a seed, Potolo orbits the star Sirius in the constellation Canis Major. Dogon, the star Potolo, is the eye of the world, a germinating seed from which they receive all knowledge. Each 50 years, throughout all the villages of the tribe, the Dogon pay tribute to Potolo in the ceremony of the Sigi, illustrating in dance the ellipse of its orbit around Sirius. Half a world away, astronomer Charles Alcock of the California Institute of Technology, with Thomas Bellows, a computer programmer, searched for scientific truth in the Dogon legend. Astronomers now know that Sirius does, in fact, have a small companion star invisible to the naked eye. The coordinates from these observations will be fed into a computer to determine the size, weight, and precise orbit of the sacred star. The computer now confirms what the Dogon have known for centuries. A small, incredibly dense star makes an orbit around Sirius every 50 Earth years. In a sacred cave, the elder Amandingi explains the significance of Potolo to initiates of the Sigi ritual. Potolo is invisible to the eye, but not to the spirit. Thus, when men perceive Potolo, they are spiritually renewed. The star is heavier than iron or any earthly substance. To them, it is the creator being, and it is heavy with the life of all worlds. Potolo is the germinating seed sending out its shoots that are the creation of all life on Earth and all life throughout the universe.
After a lot of consideration, I can think of no way that a primitive African tribe such as the Dogon, without any sophisticated astronomical equipment whatsoever, can discover by themselves that Sirius has a companion star which is invisible to the naked eye.
Amandingi's words to the initiates of the Sigi ritual have the ring of truth. With insight, the Dogon have probed the mechanism of the universe. They know what science tells us, that the seed and the star are the self-same substance, elements of a single universal consciousness. For 6 years, L. George Lawrence, a Silesian-born electronics engineer, has used an abandoned prospector's cave in the California desert as a base of operations for research in a new science called biocommunications. His purpose in choosing such a remote location was to eliminate man-made electronic interference during a series of remarkable experiments.
I started my work on plans in 1962 while I was an engineer in the aerospace industry. And at that time, it was one of our goals to develop jam-proof missile components. Now, after much experimentation, my attention turned to living plant material, in particular to plant leaves. Plant leaves are able to react to gravitational changes, to temperature changes, to electrostatic fields, and so on, simultaneously. Now, a man-made sensing device cannot do this. So, as time went on, and I experimented with these various plants and plant leaves, I noted very unusual reaction patterns. Now, at that time, I thought that my equipment was defective. It did not occur to me that I was witnessing a profound consciousness in these living plants. But I was an engineer, a nuts and bolts man. I needed to perfect a machine-based system just for the specific purpose of finding out the truth about consciousness in plants. And to my extreme surprise, it worked. There is indeed a consciousness in the plant kingdom.
Lawrence's latest equipment differs significantly from that of other researchers. It dispenses with the necessity to use electrodes directly attached to the subject. He has found through experiments that living vegetable tissue perceives signals with greater sensitivity than electronic sensors. These tiny mustard seeds, removed from a nutrient bath at the point of germination, will act as antennae to receive distant biological radiation. Emerging into the desert night, Lawrence prepares his equipment. At the the end of a Faraday tube, he inserts the seeds which will monitor the signals. A rotating beam splitter will eliminate radio interference. Consulting a star map, Lawrence searches for the constellation Ursa Major, the Great Bear. It is to celestial coordinates 10 hours, 40 minutes by 56 degrees that he will direct his instrument. Lawrence scans the heavens, waiting for the seeds to receive a distant signal. After analysis of his experiment by the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C., L. George Lawrence believes the living plant tissue in his instrument is receiving a message from outer space.
Plants communicate with each other. It would also appear, in our case, that we have actually eavesdropped on a communication that has gone on for millions and millions of years. And by some freak accident, by simply allowing a sensing instrument to remain pointed at the sky, we were able to intercept what seems to be a universal truth.
In the words of Amandingi, the star is the germinating seed sending out its shoots that are the creation of all life on Earth and of all life throughout the universe.
In the actions of the plants that I perceived a prevailing unity that is within all things. The mote that quivers in ripples of light, the teeming life upon the earth, and the radiant suns that shine above us.
From a droplet to the Milky Way, from subatomic to galactic, the germinating force of seeds and stars molds and remolds in metamorphic rounds. Thank you. Upon this planet, plants have engendered all that is colorful and tasteful, that makes you feel and dream.
Asters to zinnias, sun reflecting, give multicolored spectra, shading from violet to cherry, through fuchsia, iris, orange, indigo, and rose.
It is they, the plants, that give us flavors, raspberry to cocoa, sassafras to coffee, and vanilla. Plants give the bite in pepper, nutmeg, cinnamon, and curry.
Plants waft the fragrance of tuberose, of jasmine and gardenia, of garlic, leek, and scallion.
Plants give the feel of cordage, sailcloth, surplices, and shrouds.
And dreamland without end they give, from hop and vine, from cannabis and coca, and in extremis, the relief of laudanum, and the final sleep of Morpheus.
For they are life, the orgone green in leaves. They live in you, and when you die, your flesh will live again in other plants, and from those plants more men and women fare, and on and on.
This touches on something else that I've always said to people. It's that we have disrupted the cycle on the earth. When we started burying our dead in coffins, that's not the cycle of life. And so in the process of now using coffins, not just wooden coffins, natural, but these plastic boxes, and we're putting it in the earth, that poisons the land. You know how many coffins have been buried? And then it's like, they fill your body with a chemical to preserve it. And so your body doesn't even break down naturally. And it's just one of those things. That formaldehyde is going back into the earth, and that causes pollution too. And people just don't get it. So when they say empty feeders, that's an accurate description, because we all have gotten out of touch. People trying to preserve their dead body. It's just weird.
Aware of love, hate, and the whole spectrum of human emotions, are not plants the perfect monitors of Earth, observers of infinite patience, enduring for millennia amidst the chaos of the human condition? Spread across the face of the land, what message do they pass from this to other worlds?
Eyes that view these endless scenes are numberless as stars. The viewer, one.
Crystalline, kaleidoscopic, life snakes its way through the alchemy of mortal coils, creating and destroying form.
Understood for the first time that ancient message proclaimed by my ancestors on the banks of the Ganges 30 centuries ago. They who see but one in all the teeming manifoldness of the universe, unto them alone belongs eternal truth, unto no one else.
We're gonna go west.
spread across the face of the land, what message do they?
The sound went out. I wonder why. Well, I thought the sound was going to come back in, but it didn't. So now I'm going to have to go look for the movie. Peace and power, and I'm out.